meeting to order, and first order of business is the consent agenda. Forgive my voice, I woke up with some presumed allergies this morning. We have the minutes from July 13th. We have several warrants, both for accounts payable and for payroll. I'm not going to read all the numbers off. We have an amendment of payment agreement for the sewer impact fee for Shelburne Coffee Roasters. And we have a one-day liquor license for top of the campus, McGurk Stadium, for three dates. Looks like September 27th, October 1st, and October 29th. So any questions, comments on the consent agenda? Okay, if none, would anybody like to make a motion?
I wasn't here on the 13th, so I can't move.
Yeah, so moved.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, great. We always allow for public comment, so we'll open the public comment period now. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to make public comment?
No.
John?
I'd like to get a feeling from the Board of Selectmen on this proposed project in North Hadley. If the board is going to support this, we're going to expect something of it. Because there's an awful lot of time going to be invested in this and a lot of energy in it.
Mm-hmm.
I really don't feel like spending all that time and all that energy and spending up everybody else's time for something that the board won't even support. I've heard some rumors around town, and there are rumors, there's always rumors. And I just don't want to know the feeling from the board.
Okay, well, that's not something we can discuss tonight because it's not an agenda item, but we can certainly work to put it on a subsequent board meeting.
So I think the North Hadley Village Hall Fire Substation Committee is supposed to meet with the selectmen at their presentation, so I think that's when we should talk about that.
Right.
That should be coming up pretty
soon.
When
is that going to be?
We'll be looking to schedule it in August.
First time you meet in August.
Yeah, our first meeting in August is August 10th. So we can make an effort to put that on. Okay. All right. Okay. Any other public comment for the public comment period? Okay. If not, then maybe we can take before our appointments.
Hang on one second.
Yeah.
The consent agenda.
Yes.
I made a motion and seconded it, but I need to strike the shoulder coffee roaster.
Because it relates to a certain impact fee.
Yes.
Okay.
All right.
Do we want to re-motion that then?
Yes.
Okay. Could I have a motion then to approve the consent agenda?
Except for Shelby Brown's coffee roasters.
Right. Okay.
At this time.
Okay.
I make a motion to accept the consent agenda.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 And then do we need to motion the Shelburne Falls because he made a motion without it?
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right, now we're good. Thank you, John, for the catch. Okay, so what I'd like to do then is jump ahead on the agenda, and since it's only 7:05, we have the Hadley Public Access Television folks here. And hoping to get them in and out since they waited so long last time. Okay, so this is to discuss the Cable Television Advisory Board and whether or not we should be granting more supervisory control over the operations of Hadley Public Access Television and the appointment of new committee members. David, you want to?
So this is a continuation of a discussion that we've had for, I want to say it's been going on for six weeks now. Right now we have an advisory committee to Hadley Public Access Television with a direct report of the station manager to me. Given that we are now in a new world with respect to Hadley Public Access TV, most significantly being that because we're moving the town to compliance with the Department of Revenue funding requirements, which take effect not this July, but next July. There's a different way that the whole funding unfolds. We've placed HPAT into an enterprise fund as opposed to allowing it to live off of its gift account. So there are certain controls, there are certain procedures, there are certain realities that we have to pay attention to. But also we're talking about expanding some of the opportunities for services for the town and having an advisory committee become much more involved in not the day-to-day operations of HPAT, because we don't need that. Richard does a fine job as station manager, but the overall programmatic content, purpose, vision, as well as preparation for the next budget cycle, and how do you provide those public services to Hadley taxpayers. You know, everybody is concerned about the amount of work that's on my plate, having a committee that could work with Richard to look at the bigger picture certainly would help me, and I think would be best for HPAT. And when you think about it, I'm going to, if you want to hum the battle hymn of the Republic, go ahead, but when you think about our democracy and getting the word out to the people, this is one of the most effective and efficient means of doing it. We have a lot of opportunity here to do it better, and I think that HPAT deserves the attention that is warranted for that vital function of maintaining transparency in a democracy, and the committee, as I've proposed it, certainly could help out in that way. The last thing to say is that I know that there's been some concern about me just saying this is the way it's going to be, so I've opened the door, I've allowed people to say that there's another model that may work better, so this is an opportunity for them to present an alternative vision of where we want to go. But we really need HPAT to be run effectively financially so that we don't run into trouble at the beginning of the next fiscal year. And we want to make sure that HPAT is fulfilling its mission.
Okay. Thank you. So with that said, Elsie, are you the spokesperson for HPAT tonight? Rats. Okay.
What do you mean by that, Madam Chairwoman?
I just had to do that, David.
I think David did a good job of explaining what we're doing here. In very simple terms, we want to move, or we're willing to move, from being advisory to being a policy programming kind of setting organization. Richard continues to run the station as he always had. I see no big changes. Mm-hmm. Other than that, if a majority of our committee suggest something and everybody likes it or is in favor, we go with it. Mm-hmm. So we've been doing this for several years now. We feel just being advisory is not worth it. It doesn't really do much for Richard, does nothing for us, hasn't helped the town or the subscribers. Mm-hmm. So we'd like to give this a shot. Can I read a 45 second, which is sort of going to be a rehash of what David just said, but today's date, and I'll print this out. The Community Access Television Advisory Committee has discussed taking on a broader supporting role for Hadley Public Access Television. We have not formally deliberated on this, but if the board says yes, then we're going to put some structure to this. We're already looking at what other towns are doing. With the goal of improving all aspects of HPAT's operations and services, including its working relationship with the town and town departments, and its ability to provide a broad range of desired programming, our committee, under the supervision of the Select Board, agrees to work with the station manager and staff to, and here's a short list of the things, you know, the functional areas we think we can help with, set policies and procedures, create goals and objectives, develop budgets and financial planning tools, set capital purchasing priorities, develop human resource policies, new laptop here, guys, sorry. Expand the use of interns and production assistants, expand programming, especially local programming, including town department programming, explore opportunities to attract revenue, that could mean finding underwriters and sponsors for programs, which is legal. In short, the committee will now function more as trustees do, or commissioners do, setting policies, goals, and objectives by majority vote. We have begun collecting information from neighboring community TV stations, and we'll be suggesting more specific recommendations on our structure to the Select Board in the coming weeks. And And so that's pretty much it. So if we get a clear message from you tonight that yes, we want you to become more supervisory, we'd like to give that a shot. Richard's a little nervous about it, we're a little nervous about it, but I think it could work very well and will attract people back to our committee who left when they got frustrated feeling that their voices weren't being heard or good ideas weren't being tried and stuff. So I'll repeat what David said. TV5 is what we've got in this town as a communication channel goes. If a catastrophe were to happen and police and fire really needed to get the word out, yes, there's cell phones, but a lot of people are at home watching TV5. We've seen some great programming or little documentaries being done by Hopkins kids. Mm-hmm. We'd love to get them on. Anyway, I won't go on about all the cool stuff that we've talked about over the coming years. So we'd like you to favorably consider giving us a little more authority. We are not interested in running the station. Richard does that very well, very efficiently, at very low cost to the town. So that's, I guess I should shut up. Yeah. Thank you.
Any questions for the committee members or David from the select board?
Not a question, just a sort of a little statement.
Sure.
Years ago, about 30 years ago when I was a selectman, and we worked with Belchertown on creating cable television. And along came with it the infancy of our own television station, and it had to grow. Richard was a great part of that.
30 years?
It's about
25,
excuse me.
30 years.
Somewhere around
you're
there,
not
I know. But I remember we had a debate for selectmen, and we had to go to Belchertown and use their town hall for the debate so it could be televised. We've come a long way.
Right.
Today we take care of our own needs, and Richard and his assistant do a wonderful job, but it's no different than any other department in this community. They answer usually to a committee, someone does, and it's basically a suggestion. You put your heads together and hopefully we'll come up with a better product, you know, and I look forward to working with you people as your liaison.
Thank you.
Anything else, John?
Oh. So I'll say one more word. You know, we're all a little nervous, you know, because it is a change.
Sure.
I think dispute resolution, like if we take a vote and Richard really strongly disagrees, I assume the first level of mediation is through the town administrator, and that's fine mm-hmm. with us.
Yeah.
And if we still can't figure stuff out, then I guess we would come to you mm-hmm. and you would make the call.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
That makes good sense based on the way that it's been laid out.
Okay.
I'm fully supportive. I mean, again, I think that, you know, Richard's done an awful lot of really good work, but I think that having more heads, you know, put to the task, there's an awful lot that we can promote about our town
right.
and get the word out.
Right.
Yeah. So, does anybody want to make a motion to move forward then with the initiative?
So moved.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Can I say something or am I invisible here? I still haven't heard the reason why you think this is necessary. I mean, why does us changing from a gift account to an enterprise fund suddenly require a new committee?
It's not about that.
Yeah, it's really...
That's what David said.
No, I mean, I don't think, Richard, what we're talking about is any sort of requirement. I think it's a desire on our part. And I think the select board's being supportive of the folks who have been most involved with public access television and recognizing that, like, you know, many areas in town, we want to keep moving forward. And in order to do that, we here don't have the time, energy, and focus to be able to apply it.
Exactly,
to.
Call them involved. I mean, they're very unresponsive, especially during crisis situations.
But I think we're totally talking
me.
About change.
Yes.
Forgive me for interrupting, but I think we're talking about totally changing that, Richard, to them being more involved and feeling that their voices will be heard. I think if you turned around and asked them themselves that they want to be more involved and they'd like to represent the town and other people's thought processes with that, nobody said anything about
mm-hmm.
not being involved.
Mm-hmm. Richard, this is about getting you more support. I think if you don't find it after we do this, you're going to have a legitimate beef. But I think you're going to find it. Really, give it a chance.
Yeah, I've done some research using the Alliance for Community Media listserv that I subscribe to, and I was unable to find one example of a municipally operated public access channel that had an advisory committee with supervisory power over their executive director / station manager. And a couple of people wrote back to me and said they've heard cases where this has been tried and it didn't work out.
Mm-hmm.
so.
Well, again, it's an advisory, you know, it is an advisory committee of sorts, just from a structural standpoint, as David Moskin pointed out, to the extent there's any sort of dispute or issue, it's still going to go to the town administrator and ultimately to the select board if necessary. Again, this group is going to be acting in a very focused manner to help with programming, policy, et cetera. So I think what you're hearing from us is where the select board wants to move the public access television forward, and then if it doesn't work, then we're all ears as well. So, okay, so I appreciate where you're coming from, but I think we want to give it a try. I haven't put it to a vote yet, but I mean, we've got a motion made and seconded up here. Any?
One other last comment. I think it may enhance volunteerism, because these people will now feel they're part of the decision process. And so we may have more people coming forth to volunteer for this committee. At least I hope it does work that way.
Exactly. Now, that was one of our main motivations for doing it, is that we've lost some good people from the committee who just felt like they were not having an influence. So thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so we have a motion made and seconded. So all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Abstain.
Abstain. All right. Yeah, okay. All right, three, one abstention.
I had a question.
Okay,
I think we need
to keep moving this meeting on.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, good luck, looking forward to it. Okay, we do have appointments. So we have the fire chief and the police chief here this evening to review goals and objectives, and I do understand that the police chief is would like to go first. So, welcome, Mike.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Do we need to do a formal appointment of individuals for this?
We've already appointed them. So we've just charged the committee with a mission.
Yep.
So they're appointed already.
Okay.
And they're three or four.
Three.
Go ahead.
Two openings. Two openings.
Yeah.
So there are two openings.
There's still two openings
for the community access television.
Yeah.
So there are two openings if anybody's interested in participating on that committee. And you can send your any interest to the municipal offices. You can send it to our Hadley Select Board Assistant or David Nixon. Okay. Chief, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay, so I'm here to present my goals and objectives to the board for the next approximately a year. You've already seen, I hope you have, I emailed to David. You've already seen these within my police department and communications department 5-year projection plan. I did kind of pluck them out and put them into a separate document just to make it a little bit more ease of access. But just very quickly, so because you have them in front of you to read. Going over my completed and in-progress objectives, these were the ones that we talked about last time that I gave to David very early on, and we didn't actually get them approved by the board. The first two were two of the biggest ones for our agency, which was to create and implement all of our policies and procedures.
Mm-hmm.
And you saw all those. You saw the difference between what we had and what we have now. So those were really two of the most major ones that we dealt with.
And Chief, if I could just, you might notice there's some shuffling up here. We actually don't have them in front of us, but I am aware of the fact that you did submit them a while back.
Yes.
So
they do exist.
They do exist, yeah. So go ahead.
I can email them again if you need. So the third one that I had on the completed and in progress ones was to review and create a list of attainable goals which were derived from the Hadley Police Department management study, which was done about 6 years ago. My time frame for that was that it should be completed by mid-2016. The list and the analysis of those goals is actually listed also in my SWOT analysis as well. I identified four that I thought I could attain and, you know, successfully implement by that time frame. We're close on most of them, but some of them require, as you can see, you'll see with number one, hire 3 new police positions. This was suggested in 2010 with that study. We are obviously working towards that right now with all of the boards and committees. promoting another supervisor, which would give us three. That was another suggestion that was made. We are hopefully going to be taking care of that tonight. Create an appropriate hierarchy with structure. Our new policies are accredited policies, and they actually require that we post a flow chart of what our hierarchy looks like within the walls of our department, and we have already done that. We just simply need to add some names to it after tonight. And to create three new positions out of our new hires. One of them was an investigatory position, a detective, a school resource position, and the third one I kind of added myself, which was a traffic position. This is something that not only will take some burden off of the patrol officers, if we can expand our skill set and train someone to investigate significant crashes rather than having to contact the state police every time we have some type of bodily injury crash, we can have someone that can do that on our own. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, citations. You know, very plainly, that's revenue. Number three on my last list was to update our technology, and we secured funding for that. The town people gave us almost $7,000 at the last town meeting to work towards that. That was not only a police department and communications department goal, that also included the fire department, and we are working to integrate those two systems so that we can become more efficient. Mm-hmm. Future, working into the future. This first one was kind of combined just because we haven't yet completed it yet, but it was, we required more supervision. I obviously wrote this a while ago, as you can tell, because I wrote that I had been observing the three individuals who did apply for the supervisory position over a significant period of time. Two of them certainly, all of them, stepped up to the task, but two of them significantly stepped up and showed that they have significant leadership skills and people that I can trust to help lead the department. The second one was to create a new job description and investigate the legalities of removing our lieutenant position, one of the lieutenant positions, or both, from the union. You and I have had conversations about this in the past for a long time about creating a true second in command that is not within the union. That creates a lot of issues. We don't need to go into those right now, but a true second in command is something that is very important for us. And I've already been going back and forth quite a bit with the Mass Chiefs Council. He's done these types of things before, and he's assisting me and walking me through the process. There are certain legal issues we have to get over as far as removing it from the union, as well as creating an applicable job description that will put a person in this position that can actually help us negotiate contracts and things like that. At this point, that's impossible. And doing this will actually be able to do things quicker because we won't have to go to a town meeting to create a new position. Right now, our charter and our bylaws have sergeant, lieutenant, and chief, and patrolman. Obviously, if we wanted to create a captain or a deputy chief position, we have to go back to town meeting and get those positions actually named. But then you're also going to have to pay those positions at a more appropriate level for what they're named. With a lieutenant, we would simply need to create a lieutenant's pay scale, and we can do that through an MOU. So the time frame for that is that we require the new officers that we are given, however many that may be, to get through the academy and out working before we can work towards adding more salary to our, a higher salary to our base. The next one is, again, kind of a jump off of the last one, which is the creation of those three positions that I talked about, the detective, the school resource officer, and the traffic car. A lot of that is also going to involve some direction and some cooperation with the select board, just because we need to know how many positions we could possibly get. We are already working towards the detective position. We've identified a couple of people who are very skilled at investigating crimes, and we owe it to the town to be able to do that. So that one is top of the list. That one is going to be immediate. And school resource officer, that's actually required by law. However, they put a loophole in that basically says if you have the funding, it's required, but if you have the funding. We are going to do a quasi-school resource officer. I want to offer the schools somebody that they can get to know, somebody that they recognize, somebody that they can have a cell phone number of. Not necessarily somebody who's going to have an office within the school. What you picture a school resource officer being, that it's not, we don't have the money for that, we just can't do that. But we're going to give them someone that they can have contact with. So we're going to have to create a job description for that as well. Number four is to investigate and possibly implement a change to 12-hour shifts. This is obviously going to cause some controversy. There are certainly positives and negatives to this. This is something that will require impact bargaining, it will require legal counsel, it's not, for some of the officers it's going to be very popular, for others it'll be very unpopular, but the reason that I want to look into this to see if it is feasible is simply because of the cost savings that it looks like we may be able to have with switching to 12-hour shifts. There's some things within our schedule that we actually would require less manpower if we add hours to each officer's day. But again, that's for another day. Create a grant writing position with job description. I have two officers who've shown interest and skill in this area. They've already written a couple of different grants. Free money, it's always a good thing, but that's something that we really need to look into, and once again, the time frame on that is basically immediately upon locating a training class for this type of thing after the new fiscal year began. And the last one is investigate potential cost savings on leasing cruisers. There are a couple of interesting things that have been happening lately with cruisers as far as cost savings. A couple of the officers have approached me with a couple of ideas that they've had and some programs that are out there that would give us some significant savings. There's leasing programs. There's also certain ways that we can purchase cruisers from, you know, appropriately from the bid process, but then upfit them by subcontracting that work out. I just want to investigate that and make sure that we aren't going outside of what the law requires as far as purchasing those things. But we'd like to work towards figuring out a way to do that, because they're getting more and more expensive. The lights, the radios, everything. It's just, you know, you could get a cruiser 5 years ago for $30,000+, now they're $45,000. So.
Well, we were talking about that. The initial cost you got of the new cruisers are all the new radios and lights, because you're going from one type of vehicle to another. So.
Right.
Once you catch up with that, hopefully the radios and the lights will still work. And
hopefully. But you said the key word, catch up. Yeah. We're always playing catch up with the cruisers.
Hadfield leases their cruisers.
Do they? We're going to look into the program and see what we can do. It's maybe a little bit different from Hadfield, especially if we get more manpower, we're going to need more cars, but it's definitely something to look into.
Okay. So our task tonight then is to decide whether or not we want to accept the goals as presented by the chief, and then that's what he will be evaluated on come the end of the fiscal year. So any additional questions for our chief?
Just a quick comment. We spent the morning about 3 hours in Granby's new safety complex, which is about 5 years old, touring it with the fire chief and police chief, and they applied for a SAFE grant too, just like we are, and they told us that was the best thing that ever happened to them. That allowed them to go from basically part-time ambulance service to 24/7 ambulance service using fire personnel. And I asked them at this point, how are you doing financially with it? And he says, right now, we're about at break even. And we're not losing money, but we anticipated to turn the corner and start making money. But the SAFE grant was a godsend to them, and I hope it could be one to us.
Are they still receiving the SAFE grant?
Yes, they are. They have one more year, apparently.
So it's break even, but they're getting money every year from the state?
Yeah.
It's from the federal government.
Yes, federal grant. Okay. All right. So does anybody want to make a motion to accept Chief's recommendations for goals?
Yes.
Second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you. Look forward to hearing your progress against your goals as the year wears on. And I believe you also have another agenda item that has to do with some appointments that you'd like us to address?
Yes.
Okay.
It's one of my goals and objectives, actually.
It is?
Check one off the list. I'm going to make them sit.
Front and center, absolutely.
I have to. Joe went down to get them all.
Yeah.
Can you switch that chair a little bit?
Oh, yeah.
Mr. Hunter, how are you?
Good, how are you? Okay. Okay. As I just mentioned, one of my goals and objectives was to get the appropriate amount of supervision for our police department. That's why we're here tonight. I have two recommendations of two of our officers to be promoted from patrol to sergeant. Doug Costa came to us in 2009, and he was hired by Chief Huckowitz. Doug had some experience in dispatch and as an officer, as he worked as civilian dispatch and a reserve officer in Southwick, and then as a patrol officer in Egremont. Since he was hired, Doug has proven to be an asset to our department in so many ways, not the least of which is the fact that he worked directly with Chief Huckowitz to create and implement the K-9 program here in Hadley. I don't know that I've ever met someone who was as interested in so many different parts of this job. When I was a sergeant, whenever I would need someone to take over a specific task, it was almost annoying how Doug always happened to be standing near me, waiting for a new job, and how interested he was in diving headfirst into anything. Doug is currently our canine handler. He's our training coordinator, which is basically officer in charge of all of our trainees from start to finish, and he keeps track of all other officers' training certificates and ensures that our entire department is up to date with not only mandated training, but he is constantly thinking progressively and pushing to do extra. He's also a defensive tactics instructor, and he handles all of our in-service training for our officers here. His knowledge of legal issues and his drive to continue to learn is an asset to our department, and I'm glad to have found someone who cares so much about this profession. So I would recommend Officer Doug Costa for the first appointment to Sergeant.
Based on the recommendation of our chief, I'd like to make that appointment.
I'd like to second that motion.
Before we vote, can I just ask if there's some reason that your sidekick is not here with you this evening to experience this?
He's generally more of a distraction in the type of environment.
I just didn't know. So unless there's any discussion, put it to a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Congratulations.
Officer Hartwright, Kenny Hartwright. Hartwright. He's a 30-year police veteran, U.S. Army military police veteran, and he came to us in 2010, also hired by Chief Humphreys. Kenny currently handles all of our firearms licensing and sex offender registration, and since I took over and started working day shift for the first time in my career, Kenny made my transition easy and has shown that no matter what the task, he is up for it. I was shocked as to how many different agencies we are required to submit certain reports or certifications to, from our building to our booking area to our cells, juvenile and adult arrest records and reports, and the list just goes on and on. The truth of the matter is that for a long while we had been in violation on some of these issues, and Kenny completely turned that around and put us in a position that we don't have to play catch up anymore. His administrative skills are second to none in our department, and the fact that a large part of an officer's life is relegated to administrative tasks, I think it will be a tremendous asset in helping us to streamline certain procedures so that we can make our agency more efficient as we move forward. He has also promised that if I promoted him, he would give up playing baseball, which would drop the injuries in our department by at least half. So, Officer Hartwright is my second recommendation for a sergeant.
Excellent. Is there a motion?
Based on the motion of the Chief of Police, I'd like to recommend that Officer Hartwright become Sergeant Hartwright.
And do we have a second on that?
Yeah, I'll second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Congratulations, Kevin.
Thank you, sir.
Officers to come in, just out of the hallway.
All the officers, please come inside.
What was that, sir?
All the officers, come inside. All.
Comfortably speak on behalf of the select board, and I probably can comfortably speak on everybody who lives here in town and all the folks that pass through, that we just want to thank you, each and every one of you, for everything you do for us every day, how hard you all work. You're working as a team, and a lot of you have a great sense of humor. I don't think, I know all of you that well, but the ones I do, I sometimes wonder what goes on down there, but it's really...
So do I.
But, a lot of times these things are unspoken, so obviously we're here tonight to, look forward to these two appointments that have just been made, but we don't want anyone else lost in the sauce. We appreciate each and every one of you. So thank you for everything you do for the town.
Thank you.
And on a serious note, after the last couple weeks and all the baloney that's been going on, we would like to tell you that we really appreciate you each and every day, and we don't need a catastrophe to tell you that. Thanks for all you do. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Before you depart, I'd only like to thank you, but I would also like to thank our other people that put the uniform on every day, our fire personnel. They're in the same boat with you, and they're as sad as you are for your officers. And they have to think every time when they put their uniform, what am I going to confront, And the general public doesn't understand today what this situation is doing to our officers mentally. They're carrying a big burden, and we can't thank you enough, both departments.
Thank you. Hey, Mike, how'd you go? I don't think so.
How's your road work, budget looking?
Luckily, it's not mine.
Great. Thanks, Jim.
They're going to land based.
All right, next up, it looks like we have Chief Spanknebel.
Thanks, Chief.
I must offend. All right. Thank you for having me out for my goals and objectives. And I also did, I did an addendum to the 5-year phase approach that we talked about on June 1st. So I don't know if you want to go through all that at the same time, because it's kind of goes together. It's up to you if you want to discuss that after. I see you have that later in the agenda.
Probably after, yeah.
So basically, some of my objectives have pulled through from last year's. The first one, daily operations, is remaining on my goals and objectives. Just because of the layout of the department right now, and what's clearly stated in the SWOT analysis that I completed, because of the staffing that we have right now, there's just so many daily tasks that have to happen, and that's got to be the priority. So going to calls, getting the workload done in the office, on top of all the bills and everything else that needs to happen. So that's what's happening with that first one, and that's red for a high priority. Again, focus on completion of projects. We did knock off a number of those last year, but there's still more to go. So the North Hadley Station project is still in kind of in flux right now. The fire truck has been ordered. It's being built at this point. That was another major task that was taken on by myself and six other members of the department. And I'm happy to say, just a thank you to the Hadley residents. Tonight we had our first drill with our new, they're called hydraulic jaws tools that will be on the new engine. So state-of-the-art equipment that the town, we put all this together as part of this build out of this new truck. And I can tell you that these tools cut the time, I would say, in half of what we had with our hydraulic tools. They're all run by electric power. They are extremely fast, and we practiced tonight over at the station, so you'll start seeing the extra vehicles that are parked over there.
The upside down or sideways ones?
That's correct. That one was cut apart today, and we really pushed the tools to the max tonight so we could really see what they can do. And we had the opportunity to let some of the younger folks actually handle these, and we actually set it up so that these young folks were put into some stressful situations where there weren't senior officers on scene, so that, for example, there are many nights where we'll have two people show up. So we want them to understand that there's a possibility that they may be the first on scene and have to establish command and make sure everything's safe around them to work and make sure the people coming into the scene are safe as well. So we really exposed that tonight with the officers that were there for it. And these are the kind of projects that we want to try and get completed to make sure that we're using these tools properly, and that was really great tonight. So I want to say thank you to the town, because that was part of that appropriation for that fire truck. And if they ever want to come out and see them, we'd be happy to show them, and we'll probably be doing a demonstration this fall. Training for Lieutenant McKenna continues. He completed his SAFE program training with the state fire marshal, which was the task last year. So this year we are working together on him taking over that program that I established when I became full-time. It used to be more of a visit to the station, get on the fire truck, get some helmets and stuff. We are now actually, we apply for state grant funding that supports this program, where we're educating kids from K through 12, and now we also incorporate in senior training, senior SAFE training. Again, the town of Hadley being the first one to employ that senior SAFE and win that first senior SAFE award through the state. So we're very proud that we were part of that initial build out of that program. We're awaiting the state, when they adopted NFPA 1 as the new code. So we went from a book that was this thick to this. And they are still putting together the second phase of training for that, which goes into the meat and potatoes, which was what we were hoping to have Nick done, but that program's not complete at the state level. So both him and I will be going through that program together. And when it comes out, we'll be attending that. I have a lot more background for the plan reviews, having the construction background, but also just the years of training through the Marshal's office with engineers and everything. So the majority of the major plans for building sprinkler systems and fire alarms, I'm still taking on those plan reviews because they're quite intense and time consuming, and there's a lot of little details that you really need to take a look at under the new code and just to make sure that they're done properly. But Nick is certainly starting to get the grasp of what he needs to be looking at when we're out doing these inspections. So he's getting a good understanding of that. So the next one is completion of draft of fire department and dispatch center standard ops and procedures. So the union signed their contract now so that there is dual command structure now for both the police and the fire chiefs. So Mike Mason and myself, along with Mitch Cook, and potentially now that he has additional supervisors, we'll be working together to build out the rest of the dispatch SOPs and SOGs for both police and fire. So that'll be a little bit more clear. We're also working on how we want to, if we need to actually build out documents that they have on their workstations with some sort of a flip chart. We're also looking into this new IMC equipment that we're getting to see if we can incorporate it right into their system. So if they dispatch fire for a motor vehicle accident, inside their dispatch will be a list of questions that they can ask the reporting party. And so that's the kind of detail that we're going into now for the dispatching, because all this information is huge when we're dispatching police and fire. And then also we are continuously working on fire department SOPs and SOGs, so that's constantly in flux. We were just talking tonight about establishing new guidelines for the new jaws that are now being put into operation. So start to finish on how those are going to be put out for use, for example. We have, the next one is evaluation update and training exercise of the Town of Hadley Community Emergency Response Plan. This past year, we completed the update of the local hazard mitigation plan, which is required in order for us to apply for hazard mitigation funding. So you had appointed a committee that we had David Nixon, Ann McKenzie from schools, we had Marlo Warner, DPW, we had two Board of Health, Dick Tessier and Mrs. Gould were represented them, and Mike Mason, myself, and Johnny Mitch representing the planning board, Tim Nyhart for the building code, and I'm not sure if I missed anybody else, but we reviewed and went through, Eddie Keeler also assisted. We reviewed and updated that plan that you have to do every 3 years or 5 years, and that has now been presented to MEMA. We'll then go to FEMA, and then we'll be brought back to you. I had forwarded it to you or to David, so you can take a look at that. If there's any comments or changes that need to be done, if you find anything out of the ordinary, just let us know, and we can. This is it's a living document, so it can be amended. So now that that's complete, that gets phased into it's called our SEMP plan, so our Community Emergency Response Plan. So that handles more than just natural hazards. It's kind of an all hazards plan that we have a lot of information that will go into that document. We're also working with the Hampshire Regional Emergency Planning Committee, which I'm the chairman of, that we are currently working on a state grant. We're hoping to receive up to $50,000 that we can use regionally for training and exercise, and we're partnering up. We've already met with, and they are on board, the Hampshire Mall and Cinemark for conducting a regional exercise on active shooter training. And that way we would start with a tabletop, working all the way through functional exercise. We'd actually have folks dressed up. And as you know, with the climate nowadays, it's not happening just in the big cities, it's happening in smaller communities. So we feel it's critical that we have a minimum understanding, bringing in all of our partners of how we would handle this. And and the types of things that we need to change in our plan that fits for the town of Hadley. So myself, Mike Mason, and some of his staff, we're all working with the Hampshire Regional Planning Group to put this forward if we get that grant funding. We are also, Mike is also working on it. Even if we don't receive the grant funding, we've been working with the mall for a number of years now. And regardless of whether we get that funding or not, we're going to make sure that plan is in place and at least the initial portion, the initial response of police and fire and emergency management are ready to go.
So mall assuming responsibility, fiscal or financial responsibility, is that the...
Initially, under our initial discussion, so the grant funding does provide for some equipment. The mall has, it's not officially in writing, but has stated that they would be requesting for a second set of all the equipment that we would be looking for and would be hosting. So, you know, taking care of any food costs or all that kind of stuff. So they are willing to be a partner in all this and assist with it as much as they can. Also, the schools. The schools were a big topic this past year for both police and fire. Myself, Sergeant Cook and Mike Mason went to advanced ALICE training, so we brought that back to the schools and we did an all-hazard presentation at the schools. And we need to move to the next phase, which is actually a functional exercise of seeing how we can evacuate students from a school to an alternate location and then reunify them with their parents. So working with the schools, we're in the process of developing those MOUs and those plans, memorandums of understanding, with malls, with school bus companies, all that stuff. So that's what we're looking to get completed by the end of this fiscal year, by June. We'd like to have that all in place and ready to go. So that's quite a big chunk right there, just on the emergency management side.
Where's the state at with emergency management preparedness for something like this right now at this point?
For active shooter? It's one of the hottest topics right now, especially in mall scenarios. Schools have been, obviously, it's been an ongoing thing continuously, but we're actually looking at a pretty substantial regional exercise where you will see Franklin County state assets coming in, everything coming in to exercise on this if that grant happens. There's a number of grants that we're working on regionally that Hadley will be hosting, and because we have an awful lot that goes on in this community. So we're kind of a centralized location, and I think it's important that we be able to exercise this. Hatfield has signed up for, it's a MAC project. It's a way you can set up for additional support of an incident, and we're gonna be doing a training over in Hatfield. They've agreed to help out with that. And so we're stepping up as well, and I think it's going to be a home run for our community, especially to be able to complete that type of a plan. The final one, which is also in the red, is review of staffing levels of the fire department and then the ambulance scenario. And I would just like to add to Selectman Paczynski's comment about the SAFER grant. So the SAFER grant is a two-year grant, and I want folks to understand that the purpose of that is to get you phased into different scenarios. So either incorporating a fire-based ambulance service, what I want you to understand is that by bringing in those resources and having the time with that grant funding, getting that ambulance rolling, I think you'll see that our department budget will level out pretty close to where it's at right now. That's the purpose of the support of the grant, but then also bringing in those revenues. So if you have full-time staffing 7 days a week, 365 days a year, and you're breaking even at about what we're running right now for our budget, that's quite a home run, because our budget is not extremely high. If you look at the average, if you look in the MRI report, we are substantially lower on average compared to other fire departments of our size that they surveyed. So that's gonna be the bulk. So September, we're supposed to be restarting the ambulance task force or work group, and I already have a list of priorities, and I put it in here of, we want to be able to provide you with historical data, also the increases in calls during those years. We've been tracking the calls that we've been going to, so we can give you that data. We'll give you the data on what the cost per call is, the time frame of all the different possibilities. We're looking regional ambulance, we're looking at an RFP to go out, So we're going to have all that information categorized for you with actual numbers, actual costs. The chief was just talking about, leasing of equipment. They have that same program for ambulances where you can lease an ambulance rather than buying it outright. We're also going to hopefully get down to see, like I had told you, there's a lot of used ambulances out there that are in very good shape. Departments just tend to change them out quite frequently. There may be a very nice used apparatus that we could bring in at a very low cost to start off with at the BLS level. So that's the biggest one on my list to get completed by the end of the fiscal year for you, because we'll be going into the last year of the contract with Amherst. So that's what I have for my goals and objectives this year.
You said SAFER was 2 years, not 3 years?
SAFER is a 2 year, they switched it. It used to be 3 years, but it was stepped down, so you would start taking ownership of portions of it.
Yeah.
They've gone with a 2 year full pay, funded. Benefits, salaries, everything.
So any questions for Mike about his goals and objectives before we go on to the rest of the agenda with Mike? Not, does anybody want to make a motion to accept his recommendations?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Abstain.
Okay. All right, thanks, Mike.
Say aye.
I did say aye. Okay, so we have a separate agenda item, which we wanted to give you the opportunity to talk about the expanded program request for the fall, and then also your five-year plan. Give people at home an opportunity to hear what you're thinking and we'll be bringing forward.
Okay, so this document is the one I presented to you on June 1st, and it's the five-year phased approach to services for the fire department. I also included the enhanced budget that I had presented during the budget review, and I added an addendum here. It's around page 7 and 8. Sorry, it's not numbered, but it's highlighted in red, and it's under alternate phase 1. So basically, you probably don't want me to read through all this again.
Probably.
You do want me to?
No.
Okay. Anyways, there's basically a snapshot of what the fire department is up against. There's the department characteristics, our call volume. We have graphs in here for you to see how the call volume has increased. I can tell you from 2005 to 2013, it's not reflecting the EMS calls because we didn't respond to a lot of EMS calls at that point. We went to some. And then we get into phase one of this. It's a five-year project, and it's just broken down into phases with time frames. So phase one is complete. The SAFER grant has been submitted. We spent an awful lot of time on that, and we're waiting. So now the waiting game is happening. I was excited to hear from Congressman McGovern's office. I was kind of surprised. I got a phone call from one of his staff in Washington stating that he had received a letter from Congressman Neal's office that we had chipped in requesting their support on our SAFER grant. And Congressman McGovern said that his office wanted to back the town of Hadley with their cause. And they submitted a letter to the SAFER program at the federal government showing their support of our grant. So I'm sure a lot of other departments do that, but it was nice to hear that they're behind us and they understand what we're up against with our staffing and our community characteristics. So that was nice to hear.
What's the time frame again on that? When we're expecting to hear?
It can take up to a year to hear. It goes in batches, basically. I would hope that we would hear sometime before the end of the year, but I can't guarantee that. So that leads to, if we are unsuccessful on that, alternate phase one, which I updated today for you to give you a little bit more information. I was asked what we would be looking at for a five-year projected budget. So ultimately next year, if we didn't receive it, we would be applying again for a SAFER grant. So you could move everything up a year. Mm-hmm. However, we did put in this enhanced budget. We were requested to do that. And it called for 4 part-time positions for fiscal year 17, and then we were discussing it for the fall. Having spoken with David and Molly, I suggested and requested that that be put off. We don't want to get caught in the situation where we're supplanting, and we wouldn't be able to hire or keep, we wouldn't be able to use those fundings, the fundings that we would get if we received the SAFER grant. So we wanted to hold off and see what came of this grant. So that's what we have put in there, what I put in there for you under this update. I request that we revisit it for fiscal year 18 if we are unsuccessful, and then decide, you know, I think again we should maybe go through the same road and look for if we want to go with a real part-time staff, limited part-time staff, and go for the SAFER grant again and see if we're lucky. That would be my suggestion, but we should probably review that and see where we're at in the ambulance contract and what comes back with our review of, and our working group to see if we can maybe phase in something differently that would maybe also be not as much of a burden for an upstart cost. So I've requested, however, that you take a look at the office manager position that I had requested in the enhanced budget. Right now I have an office manager who's also a call force firefighter who's on the department, and she has up to 15 hours a week. She completed her firefighter one through the Hampshire 6 program, and she's going through the firefighter EMT basic program. And what I had requested, we're looking for ways of combining positions. So right now, with the 15 hours a week, that's not a lot of time to get through all the stuff that we have to do weekly. So, however, it is an extra body that can go out on a truck or to a medical call that's allowing me to get a little bit more of the office work done and get caught up on all this paper that I have, and then all the planning that needs to continue, and the SOPs and the SOGs and everything else. So as part of the expanded budget, I would like to request that you hold off on the part-time staff, and then I would like to request that you take a look at possibly changing the job description, and I am working on that and would be willing to get that to you, to change her job description to 30 hours a week. So that would then allow for our department to have myself and one full-time and then one 30-hour-a-week person that would be multitasking in the office and going out on calls. So that would provide us three staff, and then we would hope for the one call force member to show up to give us that force to start an operation. And that does usually happen during the day with one or two from the DPW. So that cost is reflected in that, the $29,100, that would be her salary for the year. And that's at her current rate as office manager. We would not need to do anything else. She would not need to have a firefighter physical. That's already been completed. She has her turnout gear. There would not be any other costs associated with that change of the position other than the salary portion. So alternate phase one, I would request that be looked at. And then phase two was implementation of the fire-based ambulance service. And that, again, that's from June 1st of 2016 through June 30th of 2020. So hypothetically, we receive the SAFER grant. We go into phase two, where we start putting together this basic ambulance. We get it licensed. We get it on the road, either under a private ambulance service, a regional ambulance service, or our own in-house ambulance service with the folks that we've hired under the SAFER grant.
And we can expect a recommendation from the committee on that as to which direction we'd be heading.
That's correct. Okay. So all that data will be given to you to review and assess, and it's going to be bringing in the 6 years worth of ambulance study, but giving you some hard numbers and some actual figures that we're going to extrapolate from historical data, and then best practice from we have two new departments that I'm interviewing, Southwick Fire Department and Southampton. They've both changed up their ambulance services a little bit and are trying a different path, utilizing call force members, and the way that they're working it and how we're trying to work it here with stipends and utilizing the call force to backfill so that you're not getting into the overtime situation. So you're pulling in call force members to cover those, you know, if somebody's out sick, or that's how they're filling in a lot of their positions.
So Southampton's override failed, though. That was the stimulus of that.
Yes, yeah. But he is still operating as an ambulance service, and he's getting creative with his ways of how he's staffing it. And he says it's been working quite successfully. So I've requested their budgets. I've requested to sit and meet with them. I'll also be meeting with Deputy Chief Norris, or Chief Norris from West Hampton. He's going to come out, and we're going to chat about his ambulance service that he's established. And I think we'll have a lot of good information for you.
But gut feeling to the citizens is that you think that the additional manpower will be offset by the expenses or by the revenues from the generation of that.
That's correct.
So that your budget's not going to go down, but it's going to be maintained.
Correct.
Okay.
That's the plan. That's the goal to have for you. So.
Mike, can I just ask a question about the spreadsheet that you provided? So
yep.
This is the FY17 program expansion.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I screwed up the 16th. Sorry.
How does the bottom line compare to what you had previously submitted for a program expansion?
This is what I submitted for program expansion.
Oh, so where it's red and it says corrected, that's not.
No, that is the corrected. This is the budget right now that I have in place right now. However, you would take out the $135,500,
okay,
and it would go back to the 50. I don't have the updated numbers yet from Justin. I think it's 59. It's either 50 or 59. So
okay.
the normal temporary wages that we pay out to the call force.
Okay, gotcha.
So the only increase would be from, I think she's 18 something to the 29,000.
Mm-hmm.
So it'd be around 10,000 and change would be the increase.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit about...
One quick second.
Yeah,
does that include medical? I mean, does that include benefits as well in this number?
30 would include health benefits.
Okay.
Can I ask one thing?
Yeah,
what type of timetable are we on with our contract from Amherst? I know they give us excellent services, and how much time do we have left if we have to renew?
We're on year two, so...
Of a three.
Year three? We're ending year two?
We just entered the second year, so we've got 2 years.
Correct. Yeah. So it's a three-year contract, so that's why we're hoping that at the end of this, you would have all that information.
And I know there's always a threat to service to the University of Massachusetts and their own citizens is beginning to be overwhelmed, and they always bring that topic up, but so it's great that we're preparing a little bit,
yep,
even if we remain the same and sign a new contract.
Mm-hmm.
The feeling of Amherst has always been that they would like Hadley to be a partner in their ambulance service. At least that's what I've experienced with the Chiefs. They don't look at it as we're trying to take back or take over something. We're looking to add another level of service, because you can see that there's Belchertown ambulances, Northampton ambulances coming into town all the time because they are overwhelmed. We're adding another layer, and then we're also bringing back revenues into our own community to support the great need of having a fire department.
You know, point of interest, we went to Granby and Belchertown, and both ambulance services said our bridge is causing them 30 minutes time to get to Cooley Dickinson,
mm-hmm,
that the bridge allowed them before. And Route 9 traffic is a nightmare for them, they said.
Yep.
But they're dealing with it. But 30 minutes is a significant amount of time.
Right. They clean everything up. As soon as I hear a siren, everybody's on the side and the pops are waving them right through. I would tend to disagree with that. I think
he's talking about
the Fort River Bridge, the detour.
Okay. Yeah, Granby impacts Granby the most because
Granby
and Belchertown. They do try. They usually come the Bay Road side.
Okay.
So Mike, I was just going to ask, could you talk a little bit about the capital impacts of all of this and the time frame in terms of, so if you were to be able to follow these phases as they're laid out.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you, in here you have through 2020, but from a practical standpoint, at what point are modifications necessary to Central Station?
Yes, basically in here, I had put in that in phase two, I would immediately apply for an assistance to firefighter grant, which is separate from the safer grant, for build out of our Central Station.
Mm-hmm.
So I explained that the AFG grant only will go for your main station. That's why we couldn't request it for the North
substation.
North Station substation.
Mm-hmm.
However, I mean, hypothetically, we have in the capital plan, it's been in there for a number of years, the ambulance build-out portion. We've had that in there for a number of years for the cost of an ambulance, including some of the soft costs. So we had put in for purchasing new with equipment, and I believe we had also put in there a fuel allowance, and that gets updated annually. So that is in that capital. I don't have that with me, but we're looking at, having reviewed a number of other communities, we're looking at approximately $200,000 to $250,000 to build out an ambulance. And then adding all the other ones, I had totaled it at $295,000 to start it up with a brand new ambulance, not a lease.
With building modifications?
The building modifications are, we modeled it after the DRA report. The DRA report put out, we sat down with the engineers and architects to build it was three bunk rooms on the second floor. If you're looking at the front of the station, just to the left of the bays where it jumps back, they were gonna build a two-story addition to that space with showers, bathroom, bunk rooms on the second floor and a small like living room area, access to the fire base from that, and then down below that would be additional work area. And that came to well over, I think it was $1.1 million for that build out. That also included the build out of the storage space in front of the station for the police. And so that's what we had actually requested that if we could use the OPM services to help us with those numbers, and we had talked about that when we were interviewing to see if they would be willing to help out, because they said that they have applied for grants before, to help us with that language to apply for that AFG grant to see if we would be successful on that as well. So that would be part of that. But the capital portion, I can get you more factual numbers, but it's kind of been put on hold because we're waiting for this phase one to.
Understood. Yeah. Just want to give people a sense of time that this isn't something that's going to happen next year.
No, we're right. Talking, it's scheduled as a 5-year phase-in plan, but that's based upon receiving the safer grant. So right. If that doesn't happen, not to say that we couldn't have any ambulance in place, but I think it would be more of a daytime ambulance service, and then going back to either the regional, service that would be coming in, or a private service, or Amherst, or whoever. If we put it out to bid, like we've been talking about with an RFP, to see what we get back in for proposals and see if we can actually use some of that funding. If it comes in less, perhaps we can use some of that funding that we're paying out now towards staffing and towards building out that staffing.
Is your SAFER grant flexible as far as if you were to say, the chief of Hadley, decide, I thank you for the SAFER grant, is it possible for us to utilize that starting 2018 after our build out is complete? Do you have that flexibility, or do they tell you that you've been approved for 2017
call? Yes, but we wouldn't be doing the build out at that time, because what we have requested under the SAFER grant, yeah, under phase one, is daytime staff. It would be 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. on a rotating 10 to 12 hour schedule. Four on, four off. So we wouldn't need the living quarters at that time. So that would be, that's under phase two. So we receive that SAFER grant, we go to the next, which is applying for that AFG grant, working on the ambulance, and then working into a 24/7 ambulance service. But there's gonna be a process with that, because we're gonna, and Joyce and I have had multiple conversations. You don't just start this up. There's a training portion. So we would be looking in to bring a partner in to assist us with this transition into that. And there's plenty of them out there that are interested in doing that. And that'll all be part of that ambulance work group that we'll get that information as well.
Something that really surprised me this morning, the chief says life expectancy of an ambulance is 10 years. They have a 208 in Granby, and they're having a new one built right now to replace it. But he also said, if you buy an older one, you can do modifications and get years back. So I guess it's a complicated situation.
Yeah, the biggest thing right now is all the ambulances, according to the state protocols, have to have the electric lift and everything in it. And that's an extremely pricey thing. So these used ambulances, in discussions with the director of medical services, you'd have to upgrade your used ambulance. So, that's I think he said around $20,000 to $25,000 upgrade. But then you, again, you're not paying $200,000, you're paying the cost of putting in that equipment, that upgraded equipment.
Okay. Any questions for David?
So you mentioned that the expanded program budget has changed. So on preparing the special town meeting warrant for the board, if you, next time you're going through town hall, if you could drop on by, we could go over the numbers. I want to just make sure that I'm representing your department accurately.
Well, I mean, that's, I mean, I'd like to hear from the select board if they feel that's the right way to go, because I did propose it as an expanded budget. So I've made the recommendation to take the four part-timers off the expanded budget for fiscal year 17, if that's acceptable, until we hear from the grant.
Based on what you've presented, that
correct.
Makes sense so, to me in light of the SAFER grant.
Yeah, so because I mean, I did propose in this, you know, this five-year approach that I requested that you, one of the biggest things in the MRI report is that you determine what you feel is an acceptable level of risk. If you don't feel that you want to take the chance and wait for that SAFER grant, then absolutely bring in that staff right now because we need it. But just remember that that staff is not going to be funded by the SAFER grant. So you will have those part-time people, and then you'll have four full-time firefighters coming on board, and then you potentially have to discuss layoffs of those people after that, because you wouldn't be able to do it during the term of the grant.
Rest of the board?
The upgrade for your assistant or your office manager, you'd rather do an office manager with more hours than bring somebody else in for 16 hours?
Well, we have that. You've provided that. So we have Evan Bryant, who we're working on because he's been extremely busy with his department. We're reevaluating to see if we need to bring somebody else. However, again, we're multitasking with one position. And, you know, the downtime, when we're not going out to the calls, if I have somebody who knows what's going on in the office already and they can handle that, I think that's a home run. We're not adding another layer here where we have to train somebody and then, you know, figure out what their role is going to be. And, you know, I think it's a good fit at this point.
Just afraid of losing an office manager to become a full-time truck driver.
No.
And, you know, we'd respond person, you know, I mean, as administrative duties increase. And, and you know, we kind of turn into having a 30-hour-a-week full-time firefighter or three-quarter-time firefighter, and you lose your office manager.
Yep. No, I actually put that in here, that we would clearly define the job description.
Okay.
So there would not be an interruption of what she has to get completed. So that's going to be very clear in that job description. So if it comes down to we're slacking on being able to get the bills out and all that other stuff, then we're going to reevaluate, come back to you and say, hey, listen, we've reined it in, and she can only make it to, you know, 5 hours of calls a week, and that's what we've had to cut, you know, dial it back to. Her first priority is the office.
David, did you have a question?
Going back to the SAFER grant and whether we're going to pursue it in terms of the funding strategy, would it make sense to present both sets of numbers at the end of August so that you can see the information of what it looks like if we decide to rely upon a grant that we don't have in hand versus full funding on ourselves? And then the select board can make that decision given all the information that's contained upon the warrant.
I hear what you're saying, but I think what Chief's telling us is that if we go with hiring of those four people now, when the SAFER grant comes out, we're in a position of laying people off because we can't use SAFER for that. So that's a fine thing to say, but anybody that was hired, I would want to make it clear to them that if the SAFER grant comes through, we love you, there's the door, and in a nice way, you know, because I'm all supportive of the SAFER grant. I think it's a great transition for the town of Hadley and what we're trying to do, but I don't want to be in a situation where these four people come in, we get the SAFER grant, and all of a sudden we're, you know, somebody feels offended that we're...
It is. At the end of that period of time when the taxpayers have to fund that, and we have to propose it to them, and it doesn't pass, then exactly that point, you know, you're putting four people that were really looking forward to coming to the town of Hadley and working for us, and you know, you'd have to let them go.
hence my point to Michael was, if we use the SAFER grant and we get this system up and online, and our cost is no more than what we have today, it's a lot easier to sell that because we have an active situation that's in place.
You know,
our budget is X. Yeah. It's now X with much greater service to the town of Hadley. And I think that the 2 years on it.
He mentioned the RFPs for ambulance services too. Why do we need to wait till September to go out for those RFPs? Why couldn't we go out for those RFPs now to see what kind of numbers you're looking at?
Well, that's what.
Then
that's
you're
the
sure which way
the,
you're going to
yeah.
go.
Yep, yeah, that's the purpose of the work
committee.
Group. Yeah, the work group is going to revisit that.
You know,
that.
Because, you know, you told me I was wrong, like, when I said it's going to be about $1 million operation, and you got a $1.1 million build-out, you got the ambulance service at $500,000, and that's without staffing it. So you're at $1.6 million right now. You know, now you're going to staff it with four people.
But you're talking about a budget. You're not talking about $1 million
budget. I mean, eventually you're going to have to staff it, and there's going to be another couple hundred thousand to $300,000 there.
But some of that's capital, so you want to be careful.
I know. But I was looking at the total when I threw that number out, and it's there.
But we're also looking at
revenues.
Potentially bringing in revenues,
yeah.
Which
and,
very
and
well
grants.
May. Yes, and the grants.
And that grants for the build out.
Yeah.
So I think it's quite obvious we're not ready to make a decision. And Mr. Nixon's early comment that he would sit with the fire chief, run some numbers, and come back to us with those numbers, and I think then maybe we'd be ready to make a decision.
You comfortable
absolutely.
With that? I'm just,
right.
It's just really side by side.
Absolutely. I think that would be a great idea. And I just, like I said, I just want to make sure that we're not hamstringing ourselves down the road. I think, like we said, we've made this a 5-year process, so let's make it a true 5-year process and make sure we don't put the cart before the horse.
Okay. All right, everybody comfortable with that?
I am.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you. Could I, would you mind if I actually, I was supposed to make an announcement, but let me see if it actually came through here. Would you mind if I made an announcement quick?
I guess we can
okay?
let that
or do, I can stay and wait till the end. The association asked me to announce that the association is having a chicken barbecue this year. It's been a few years since we've done it.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be Friday, September 16th, 2016, from 5 to 10 p.m. Dinner's going to be at 6 at the Hadley Young Men's Club. Tickets are $17 a piece and 2 for $30. There'll be live music and raffle and all the normal stuff that we have, and we'd love to have you come out. You can get tickets from any fire department member or association member, and you can call the fire station and request it. So we will get a flyer to Richard, and if you wouldn't mind putting it on, that'd be great.
Limited amount of tickets, get them early, is that what you're
We doing? Have 200 tickets out there right now. We've been known to have more around 300, so get them early. Thank you.
Yep.
Stay great on top.
And again, you don't have a whole crew to stand up here with you, but we love you too, and thank you for everything you do.
Yes, thank you. Thank you to the firefighters. I appreciate all their hard work.
We too.
Yep.
Holly, I think you've got to cut your talking. You're losing your voice completely, and tomorrow you won't
hilarious?
Be able to
yeah.
function.
It's like puberty.
Yeah.
this is the time of year my husband waits for, trust me. Okay, and then, so we had an owner's project manager agreement on the agenda, but the meeting is not scheduled due to conflicts until next Wednesday. So we'll have this on our next select board agenda. Okay, and then I think the last item is the town administrator report.
Okay. Just a reminder, we have two items that didn't make it onto the agenda because
oh, yes,
they
right.
appeared
yep.
just yesterday. The town administrator's report for July 20th, 2016, just touch on the updates. So we're continuing with the project on Route 9, the widening project. We've about 70% complete on the water work, and pressure testing performed yesterday and today resulted in at least 2 failed connections, and the contractor is performing corrective work. So this wish we were a little farther down the road than we are, but we want to make sure it's done right, and they'll do more pressure testing tomorrow after their
they fixed one and it passed today. So
they fixed there was one that passed
yeah.
over at the library. And then the one that failed over here,
yep.
did they fix it?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
But they did fix one.
Right. Okay. Work has begun on the road surface, so this is new and different. It's creating the usual inconveniences for everybody. Try to make sure that this is a project that moves as fast as we can so that as few people as possible are inconvenienced. State revolving fund update, to the treasurer's been working with the Department of Environmental Protection to make the payments that have been coming in, and current payments have been processed. We anticipate this process to go smoothly, so we're not seeing any hiccups there. Private duty detail payments, however, are running into some problems. The magnitude of this project has outstripped the capacity of our revolving fund. So most towns, the way that they handle private duty detail is that the patrol officers are hired by an outside firm. The town bills the outside firm, and then the outside firm pays the officers, and frequently that works very well. Sometimes there's a lag. In order to support our officers, quite some time ago we put together a revolving fund so that it had a kitty of about $21,000 in it. This is not money that we owe to the the detail officers, but rather we use that as a way to expedite the money so people are getting paid more frequently than under the traditional model. Given how large this project is, we've outstripped the capacity of that revolving fund. So we're looking at ways of the chief of police, the assistant treasurer, and the treasurer and I working to make sure that this process works sustainably and as quickly as possible. There's been a number of statements made about this process. I just want to give a couple of bottom lines. One is that everybody's going to get paid. Two is that our revolving fund is in the black. Not by much, but it is in the black. I've heard the statements to the others. So we'll be working on this, making sure that this speeds up and that we have a reliable source of income for the people who have to stand out in the hot weather all day long.
Get the Finance Committee involved with this process?
Finance Committee currently is not involved in this process, and they don't have any role to play. One thing that we can, however, do is we can, at the fall town meeting, we can decide that given that we have a problem with just the sheer magnitude of this project, and knowing that in 2020 there's going to be a size of an even larger project from the 47 intersection to East Street, that we may want to increase the amount of money that's in the in that revolving fund so that it has a better chance of remaining solvent during the next phase of this, and as well as the rest of this part. So we're going to explore that, and I'll be presenting that information to you.
Quick question. Yep. I mean, I know we're trying to do the right thing for the officers by what we're doing here.
Mm-hmm.
What do other towns do? Do they say the state's a slow payer, so you have to wait for your money?
Pretty much. There are some towns that do the revolving fund, but most of them are they're contracted with the outside vendor.
They're subs for the general.
Yeah. And the reason why they do that most towns is because it saves them Medicare costs on the other end, because we get assessed by total payroll. And if the payroll is going through our revolving fund, we have to pick up that cost. Now, we charge an administrative fee of 10% to offset partially that additional cost. But we're really doing it for the convenience of the officers.
We're under no contractual obligation to the union to do that.
The only contractual obligation that we're under is the size of the revolving account. We've agreed in contract negotiations to up the up whatever it was. I think it was $14,000 to $21,000. So,
how far in arrears are we?
We're not in arrears.
We're in black.
I think there's like a couple hundred dollars in that account at this point. As money comes in, we replenish the revolving fund, and then that goes directly out to whoever's in line to be paid first. Our task is to make sure that the money is coming in fast enough that we can make regular payments with as little delay as possible.
And how's that working? Well, we're still.
I know it's a big number. The 21,000's eaten up, so if it's a 30 days out, we got 30 days of roadwork officers there, so that might be $21,000 there anyways.
Right.
So, have we done a?
So we're still collecting our facts on this. I just got a report from Jackie Lipinski this very evening, so I haven't had a chance to digest it. She's responding to questions that I posed, having to do with, you know, what are our billing practices, what's been paid, what's in arrears by the contractor, not us, you know, what do we owe, and then I want to explore with the treasurer how fast do the revenues get posted to Justin so we can pay out of that revolving fund. So there's some things that we can do internally to make sure that this works as fast as it can.
This happens with any contract that we're involved with, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The pump stations are involved with that also, I believe, with the police, and it's just the way it is. It's just.
How's the payments from the state?
It's just the magnitude of this particular job. I mean, but all the other state contracts are the same. I'm sure you read in the paper the snow plowing contracts of private contractors through the state. They don't get paid till July 1st of the next year, you know. It's just the way the state operates, you know. It shouldn't be that way, but it is. And now with the state in $400-something million deficit, who knows what direction they're going in. This point,
I just want a little clarification on how, you know, yeah. With the magnitude, I certainly understand where we could eat up $21,000 in a month.
Oh, yeah,
if we easily. Need to bill weekly, we need to bill weekly. If we're billing once a month, I can see where we could get a red herring real quick.
Right. We may be, we're billing weekly, it may be that we need to bill once every 3 days or something like that.
You want to be reasonable. You know,
and the other part of that is, when do the receipts come in? When do they get turned over? When do they get posted? That's the next part of this chain that I want to
some more
explore.
Come.
Thank you.
Right.
The other day, the configuration of the traffic required 5 officers out there, which was 2 more than normal.
Yeah.
You know, it depends on what they're confronting, where they're digging, and I think it bears to mention, these funds aren't coming out of town coffers. They're all coming and being paid by Department of Transportation.
By the contract, yep.
Okay, continuing with Route 9, we have the next phase of the project. On the 13th, we met with MassDOT and other Route 9 stakeholders to plan the next phase of the overall Route 9 widening project. So the next project that's going to happen is on the Northampton side with a rotary at the Coolidge Bridge. That's scheduled for 2018. And then the Route 9 widening in Hadley up to East Street is scheduled for 2020. They'd be bidding it in 2020. MassDOT came up with a couple of configurations for the plan. They talked about a 4-lane extension from here to East Street, and they also talked about a 3-lane extension. And they presented information that suggested that the 3-lane option was the better one for traffic control and reducing the number of accidents in the next phase. They asked us for a decision. I said I was uncomfortable making that decision without bringing that to the select board. So I've invited MassDOT to meet with the select board, have them give you a presentation.
They're going to come in with both plans.
They'll come in plans with a side projector, and they'll have the information for the board. And you know, obviously, best management practices and best highway designs are something that I'm not on top of. You know, so I trust what they say, that that's a better design, but I also pointed out that it's a community process, and that there may be a community desire to see some other configuration.
The shareholders meeting was very productive, and they informed us of a lot of things that are going to occur. They're talking about a roundabout at Damon Road to correct most of that problem, the backup that ties up all of our Route 9.
That'll be interesting.
You know, so when they come in, there's going to be a lot of information for the citizens to listen to and dissolve.
Touching on a few other projects, just briefly, the HVAC control project is moving forward, and you have the contract documents to sign tonight.
public safety complex roof update. The project has been redesigned, and the bids will be released tomorrow with a bid deadline of August 29th. Municipal buildings update. I met with representatives of Goodwin Memorial Library, the Senior Center, and the North Hadley Fire Substation projects. And we're trying to coordinate information and cost projections for presentation to the select board and other decision makers so that we can integrate the information into the capital improvement plan, as well as the decisions that you have to make at the special town meeting. Just skipping down. Electricity net metering credit agreement phase two. About a year ago, we signed a net metering credit agreement for a solar development on Mill Valley Road through Nexam. This would be the second one that we've done down there. The first one we did several years ago was under the SREC 1 program, and we achieved a 21% discount on 70% of our electrical load. That 70% is five buildings. It's the wastewater treatment plant, the water treatment plant, the two schools, and the public safety complex. Those buildings are 70% of our load. And considering we spend $250,000 annually on electricity, you get a sense of how much energy those five buildings use. So right now, that's been a very successful program. And we estimate we're going to be saving between $300,000 and $600,000 over the next 20 years on just that first project alone. The second project, we signed the agreement a year ago. The facility is now getting close to going live, and so we're working with Nexamp under the SREC 2 program for a smaller discount, a 16% discount on the remaining 30% of our load. And we estimate that that's going to result in savings of about $150,000 over a 20-year period. So we expect this project to go live in the next 60 days, and we'll start seeing those savings showing up in our electricity bills. Department functions. Today I went to training on the new law that the state passed reforming the public records law. This law takes effect in January 1st, 2017. It's a sweeping reform of the public records law. The only thing that has remained the same is the definition of what a public record is and the exemptions that to the public records law. Everything else has changed, and those changes are substantial. We'll be working with the select board over the next couple of months in order to put the processes and the personnel in place in order to comply with the new requirements. New requirements involve a whole lot of new enforcement measures that make it difficult for towns. Great for the public, I guess, but difficult for towns. So we want to make sure that this process is running smoothly come January 1st, 2017, because if we don't do it correctly, there could be substantial penalties, which only goes back to the taxpayers. So let's not mess with this one up. And I guess the other things is still in process. Upcoming projects and events, that would be the Hadley Garden Tour coming up this Saturday. And the chief talked about the Fire Association Chicken Barbecue on September 16th. And just to remind everybody that we have a special town meeting coming up on October 27th, and the deadline for articles is August 31st, Wednesday, 4 p.m., and submit those to me.
Okay, thank you. And then we did have two items that needed to be added to the agenda that couldn't have been reasonably anticipated when the agenda was published. One is the contract signing for the HVAC. And the second one has to do with the voluntary water ban. Do you want to cover that one, David?
Sure. The water ban. Let me grab the right document. On July 8th, 2016, the Massachusetts Energy and Environmental Affairs Secretary Matthew Beaton issued a drought advisory for the Connecticut River Valley. It's obviously been very dry out there. This triggers a compliance requirements in our water withdrawal permit that's issued by the Department of Environmental Protection. That should the secretary make such a declaration, then the town is now required to call for a voluntary, just underscore the word voluntary, water restriction. Odd and even outdoor watering. Customers are requested to voluntarily minimize outdoor water usage by complying with an odd even schedule. Those with odd numbered addresses should restrict outdoor watering to odd numbered days, and even numbered addresses to even numbered days. Filling swimming pools. Pools should not be filled during this period of high water demand and low water supply. If we as a town can't reduce voluntarily our outside water use, it may result in an implementation of a mandatory water restriction. So we want to make sure that even though the people understand that this is a voluntary water ban, we do need to take it seriously and see what we can do about getting the word out on this. And Richard, I'll be giving this to you for TV5, as well as we need to broadcast this on the website, which is at www.hadleyma.org. If you have any questions, contact the Water Division at 413-586-8756 or email us at waterworks@hadleyma.org.
Just a little information behind that, Marlo. DPW Director Marla Warner told me we're pumping almost 1.6 million a day.
Right.
Which is substantially above what our allotment is.
Right.
So we gotta do something before it's directed.
Right. Which is under 1 million, just under 1 million.
Correct. Okay.
So I ask the water commissioners to take a vote to endorse and implement this voluntary water ban.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Abstain.
Okay. All right, thank you. And then the last item for the regular agenda is the contract.
Right, so the HVAC control project is moving forward. The contract documents came back from the contractor, all signed. It's now time for the select board to vote formally to sign the contract documents on a project that's already underway.
Any variances in the contract from what was originally discussed?
No.
Motion to sign.
Second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, so we'll take care of that. And then we are not having an executive session this evening, so the last thing would be announcements.
I just have a couple. I'd like to congratulate Coach Beckwith, mm-hmm. Coach Boysworth for the Cal Ripken 11 under state tournaments. They won the state tournament yesterday and they're on to the New England finals. Congratulations. Good. Great job, guys.
Did a good weekend last weekend out there.
They sure did.
Like and places back.
Yeah.
Yep. And as the head of the Capital Planning Committee, I'd like the board to at some point before too long get some information to us as to what actually is going to be available come fall town meetings so that we can begin the process of planning to be ready for, you know, to what we can do with that. The meals tax numbers are shortly due in or, you know, with that, so we'll take a look at the percentages and stuff like that and see what we have available. A lot of the stuff we put off from the spring town meeting because it doesn't make any sense to spend money we don't have. There's only $33,000 of it we were able, as Chief Mason was able to talk about tonight, to fund $6,800 worth of, you know, upgrades to their system there, but a lot of the needs of the community were put on hold until the fall. And there'll be a lot of jockeying, a lot of Michael stuff that's in there, I think, is going to be able to, you know, qualify for that. So the sooner we knew a little bit about that, the better we're going to be able to plan and bring a good plan before you.
August 5th is the deadline for the capital update. Mm-hmm. So we'll have that information to you as soon as that deadline comes.
Show me the money.
I'll show you the money as soon as I got the money.
We have tri-board for the 10th, correct?
Tri-board for the 10th. Select board on the 1st, finance committee on the 3rd, and the select board on with the tri board at the 10th.
Okay, so at that meeting, we should be looking at free cash estimates. We should be looking at budget to actual. Again, mm-hmm. I know be completely T's crossed, I's dotted, but we should have a pretty good sense
right.
of where we're winding up. Mm-hmm. And then capital info for you. John, you have a question?
No, I have a comment.
Okay.
You're running your meetings here. I think the way you run a meeting, no citizen or taxpayer could comment on anything. And it seems to me you don't want to listen to no one.
Okay. I don't think that's relevant
well,
tonight.
So. No, it is relative.
Does anybody have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Move second. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All right. All right, good night, everybody.